Follow the traces. Explore roots deep. Learn from the past. Futures to reap. Stay tuned for Qingqiao Safety. Detective. Chapter 2. Search across thousands of miles. It was the conclusion of Japan's bubble economy, marked by the widespread influence of a frenzied consumer culture across all social classes. Western waitresses became a manifestation of this cultural trend. In the scenario where Japanese businessmen and office workers entertained clients or enjoyed a drink, a white woman would be summoned to serve as a companion, engaging in pleasant conversations. For Japanese men, often restrained and intensely self-respecting, this experience undoubtedly provided a significant boost to their vanity satisfaction. It was no coincidence that, amidst the surge in hot money circulation, Anna and Kelly opted to work as waitresses at Casablanca Bar in the Roppongi district of Tokyo. Roppongi, particularly renowned for its nightlife, is a well-known red-light district in Tokyo. However, the 21-year-old Anna and Kelly perceived their roles as waitresses to involve lighting cigarettes, pouring wine, engaging in conversation, and singing for customers. Despite the initial apprehension, anxiety, and sense of being lost in a country with a distinct skin color, race, language, and behavioral style, Anna, freshly arrived, and Kelly maintained high expectations for the future. The two friends decided to share a six-person room under challenging living conditions. The space was cramped, dim, and far from ideal. Despite these conditions, they persevered and went to work together when the time came, leading what they considered a relatively peaceful life. Anna harbored dreams of using her earnings to settle her debts and purchase gifts for her parents. However, these aspirations were shattered by Anna's sudden disappearance. Upon Anna's sister's urgent arrival in Tokyo, both she and Kelly launched a desperate search for Anna. They combed through bars and nearby neighborhoods, attempting to identify the man who had initially called. Despite a week passing, there was still no progress, and Anna's phone remained unreachable. In the meantime, Anna's parents in England grew increasingly distressed. Eventually, they also flew to Tokyo. Faced with the unfamiliarity of the location, their sole point of contact was Kelly. In a state of desperation, Anna's father, Bernie, sought assistance from the news media. On July 13, he held a press conference in Tokyo and leveraged his financial resources to broadcast his daughter's disappearance on Japan's primetime news program. During the press conference, Bernie displayed a photograph of his daughter, appealed for assistance from the national audience, and presented some hypotheses based on the information he had gathered thus far. Bernie vehemently refuted the notion that his daughter was evading credit card debt, emphasizing that her crucial documents and belongings were still at home, suggesting it was not a premeditated escape. Additionally, he dismissed the idea of Anna joining the emerging church, asserting that both Anna's friends and family could attest that she had no involvement with church matters whatsoever. Following the broadcast, the heartfelt plea of the elderly father struck a chord with viewers nationwide. Bernie took proactive measures, printing and distributing around 30,000 posters detailing Anna's disappearance, which were prominently displayed on the streets of Tokyo. Shortly thereafter, the disappearance of a British girl in Japan gained widespread media coverage and captured the attention of British authorities. Consequently, the case evolved into a diplomatic matter between the two countries, prompting Japanese authorities to take notice. On July 15, Bernie received an invitation to meet with British Foreign Secretary Robin Cook, who was coincidentally in Japan for the summit. Cook appealed to the Japanese public to aid the father in locating his missing daughter, elevating the case's prominence. By July 18, within just 3 days, the investigative department received 100 calls from the public and amassed numerous leads, though the authenticity of these leads remained unverified. Determined to expedite the search for his daughter, Bernie initiated his own inquiry. He established an office in close proximity to Tokyo's Casablanca Bar and operated a confidential hotline manned by sympathetic expatriates to encourage those with information, but hesitating to contact the police, to come forward. Simultaneously, he offered a reward of up to £9,500. The incident resonated significantly in the UK, prompting public calls for the government to address the plight of young people in foreign countries. In a heartwarming turn, an anonymous wealthy British businessman, upon learning of Anna's disappearance, generously increased the reward to £100,000. On July 21, British Prime Minister Tony Blair flew to Tokyo, personally met with the Burney family, and pledged to formally address the issue with the Japanese Prime Minister during the G8 summit scheduled for that day. Anna's whereabouts had transformed into a matter of profound concern for both nations. The direct involvement of the Japanese Prime Minister elevated the significance of the case, prompting heightened attention from law enforcement. Numerous police officers were deployed to the Roppongi police station to intensify the investigation into Anna's disappearance. To seemingly temper the intensity surrounding the case, on August 1, a letter purporting to be written by Anna was sent to the Tokyo police. Burney was overcome with emotion upon learning this news, as if glimpsing a glimmer of hope that his daughter might still be alive. Can we uncover clues about Anna's disappearance from this letter? With the case garnering increased attention and resources, does the current situation make it more likely to locate her? Please stay tuned for the next issue, Detective of Qingqiao Safety.